taste it again tonight, and he does! Mr. Sacco!
King of the Ring, 1998.
They're fighting on a steel roof of this cell. They're using, that's a steel chair that Mankind is using.
Oh my gosh, look at this, it broke through!
This is where we realize that the cell is not as structurally sound. And this is a harrowing moment. As I realize, okay, this is put up or shut up time. I was trying to suplex the Undertaker, and he put an end to that. Because we were using the old-fashioned bicycle racks as security. It allowed my body to spin out so that half of me was in the crowd at the Pittsburgh Civic Arena. You couldn't ever have that again because the barricades have changed.
Look! And look at him. You're kidding
me! How in the hell is he standing?
Oh, my God.
And look at this. He's got a smile on his face, for God's sake.
And this moment, I just wish I had the strength to climb. My shoulder's messed up, so I can't climb very fast. Not that I had climbed very fast the first time up, but I wish I had exchanged with The Undertaker. You know, like, I was so tired, and I'd been through a lot, that when he came over, I just didn't have the strength. If I could do one thing over, I would have been throwing leather, throwing hands, as they say, and instead, I should have come back. Bam, bam, they would have. We would have had that Pittsburgh arena rocking. I mean, we did anyway, but it's like collective gasp of breath. And now look how quickly this ring fills up with people.
Good God! Good God!
That's it, he's dead.
You know, in today's WWE, in today's sporting world, we would stop a match like that. But I'm lucky that that wasn't the decision that was made. I'm also lucky there was no social media, because it would have trended for 3 days and then would have been forgotten. And instead, this match had a chance to build momentum like a snowball going downhill. And even in the days and weeks that followed, it wasn't a big deal. Within a few months, it was seen as a big deal.
My God, I've never, ever seen anything like this. The Undertaker has got Mankind back on his back now. Wait a minute. No, you. He's near those.
When I took off the mask, when I was underneath the debris of the table, I wasn't planning this, but I think what it did, even though people had seen me as Dude Love, even though people had seen me as Cactus Jack, now I'm back to being Mankind. And when I took off the mask, I think in people's minds, this isn't a character, this is a human being, and he's doing everything he is capable of doing. Somehow, some way, these two guys are going to find a way to get over the finish line.
No way! And there's a tombstone! Tombstone! On his back!
And there were regrets I had about that match and how big it was and how much it dominated the landscape of my career, to where I got tired of it, even bitter about it. It wasn't until The Undertaker came to see me at an event in Austin, Texas, and he said the words, "You know, Jack, what you and I did that night will outlive us both." I kind of looked at him quizzically. He said, "People will be talking about this match after you and I are dead and gone." And it was like a giant weight was off my shoulders. And I have been grateful for that match ever since. I'm still puzzled, but absolutely pleased that probably 40% of the people who talked to me about that match weren't even born when it took place. It's a match that parents and friends are choosing to share, especially parents, handing it down to the next generation. It's almost like kids are watching wrestling and they go, "Joey, that's great, but this is what wrestling was like when I watched it. And it's the go-to match that wrestling fans show to their non-fan friends. It may not make them a fan, but it's going to turn everything they thought they knew about what we did upside down. Raw, April 1st, 1996.
Coming down the aisle, weighing 287 pounds, Mankind!
I still remember my first meeting with Mr. McMahon when he showed me a piece of artwork that was on the table. I had thought that it was artwork for a new character designed for Max Payne. It looked like the Man in the Iron Mask. The Alexander Dumas story, later portrayed in the motion picture by Leonardo DiCaprio. So it was probably an hour into our talk before he showed me that illustration and said it was for me. And my first thought was, won't this cover up my facial expressions? And Mr. McMahon said, it's going to augment them. And at the end of those conversations, I thought, I'm going to give this a try. Not just a try, I'm going to put everything I have into this character, and I'm going to try to make it as different as I can from Cactus Jack. There'll be a little carryover in the moveset, but I'm going to have him speak differently, act differently, walk differently, feel differently.
What kind of competitor? You sort of wondered what kind of athlete this man would make. What's he doing with that? Wait a minute, look at that! Look, Polly is screaming! He's got his fingers jammed down his throat, down to his esophagus!
Mankind!
This is the first time we've seen the mandible claw on TV. Developed by Dr. Sam Shepard. Dr. Sam Shepard was the physician that the TV show and later the movie The Fugitive was based on. I knew he was going to be a tough match. As Bob, give and take guy. If he's going to be on the losing end, he's going to make you work for that. When you come out of the gate, you get a win over a guy like Bob Holly, and later on in that same show, you attack The Undertaker, you are making a statement.
State of The Undertaker.
You got two creatures of the night there.
I was terrified. This is like you see your future in front of you, and you know this is one of the moments where you have to hit that home run, right? You can't play it safe. It has to be the very best that you can do.
Down below, look out!
Oh, my gosh! Did you see that, McMahon?
What? Don't tell me he's gonna keep jamming those fingers down the esophagus.
I think The Undertaker had just grown tired of facing people who were bigger than him, taller than him, or weighed more than him. And I think he wanted to mix it up with someone who could get in his head and wage psychological warfare. And this was the first step in the first shot of that battle, which turned into an epic war between us, was me coming out and attacking him. SummerSlam, 1996. You want to make me smile, say something positive about that match. To the best of my knowledge, the first of its kind. Now, even without the announcements, I was always very vocal when I was in my matches. Something I wasn't even aware that I did. And it looks like I have the advantage here because the boiler room in my bio is kind of where I feel at home. So it's definitely a home game for me. There we go, bam. Man, there's something about watching The Undertaker. It's a treat.
Mankind, from the top ladder, Mankind. Oh! And, oh!
you hear that?
Yes, the Undertaker, the victor here tonight at SummerSlam. Give him the urn.
Now fans are starting to realize strange things afoot in Cleveland, Ohio.
Give him the urn. Mankind driving that mandible claw into the gullet of the Undertaker.
Paul Bearer's laughing. Paul Bearer's laughing.
And in the end, Paul Bearer turns on Undertaker, which nobody ever saw coming. If Paul Bearer is going to leave the Undertaker for anyone, it's going to be with the guy who used to babysit his children in world-class championship wrestling.
Oh, no!
What are you doing?
I can't believe what we're seeing.
Mankind must take possession of the urn he has, and he is the winner.
Wow!
I never thought the Undertaker and Paul Bearer would split, but if they're going to split for anyone, I'm glad it was me. In your house, mind games. Styles make matches. And HBK style was dramatically different from The Undertaker's. But I recognize that Shawn was probably the greatest wrestler of his generation. And I define generation by monthly pay-per-views. That no one came up bigger, more regularly on the big matches than Shawn Michaels did. He was under a world of pressure as WWE champion. To my credit, I understood the magnitude of this moment, and that got myself into probably my best shape in WWE. Really worked hard because I knew I was going to be in there with a better, faster athlete. I'd never worked Shawn in a singles match. I'd worked him in a handful of tag team matches, maybe as many as a dozen, me and Goldust against Undertaker and Shawn Michaels. But this was the first time we'd ever had a singles match. Shawn was he was so amazing to work with. So I'm going to attempt to back suplex Shawn Michaels, and he's going to turn it in midair into a cross body, and we go through that table.
Good Lord! Good my God, they made me the banks may be broken.
And they got Sid involved. I think there he is, the Undertaker comes out, so we're going to continue our our feud.
I don't believe it! I don't believe what we're seeing!
And I almost would challenge any wrestling aficionado to see if two guys ever had that type of chemistry from opening bell of their first singles match. One of the best things I've ever done. Royal Rumble, 1998. To this day, it ranks up there with some of fans' favorite memories. We were able to have all three faces of Foley simultaneously.
Oh! No way!
Oh! One of the things it showed just how good The Rock is that even fairly new into his career, he was able to perform with a garbage can over his head. He seemed to know where he was at all times, despite not being able to see anything. And I thought to myself, it's got to be in the blood. There's no way. This is just an innate skill he has.
Look out, there goes Jack.
My big regret is I didn't have enough time to have three separate pairs of boots with Velcro, because when I got back stage, it was like a team of people. It was like I was a race car Instead of taking the wheels off me, they were taking my, all my boots were 17 and a half inch lace-ups. And so I would have to go back, boom, like you're changing spark plugs, and then just take the boots off, get the new ones on. Okay, here comes Mankind at 16.
Oh my gosh, this ain't right!
Wait, I'm a little confused here. Somebody's not gonna have a nice day! Well, Mankind,
look at this!
Going right for Chainsaw Charlie.
Once I got out there, it wasn't particularly important what I did. It's just the fact that I was out there. And now dude only comes out for a cup of coffee, but brother, it was an enjoyable cup of coffee. And at this point, the whole crowd is there in on it. And I'm sure there were two guys backstage thinking that I cost them their spot, but we're in the memory business, you know, and we created a memory for people.
Oh, dude's got the mandible. Chase of Mankind, all low blow, Austin. Kicking Dude around some truth of consequences.
Oh, there goes Dude!
The Root eliminates Dude.
Fans just, they just completely got it. And when I came back, I had a standing ovation from the men and the women in the dressing room. And I thought to myself, really? Like, for that? Usually when I got a standing ovation, it was like I was on my way to a hospital. And in this case, it was just because we made people smile so hard. It brought two worlds together, and it made absolute sense. Raw, January 4th, 1999. There was so much going on that night. I never saw myself as being a WWE champion, the guy. Meanwhile, WCW is going to be doing their live show in front of 48,000 fans, and here we are at a taped show in Worcester, Massachusetts, in front of about 8,000 fans. On paper, these guys are going to blow us away in the ratings, but that's not what happened.
Fans, as Hollywood Hogan walks away, you look at this 40,000 plus on hand. If you're even thinking about changing the channel to our competition, fans, do not, because we understand that Mick Foley, who wrestled here one time as Cactus Jack, is going to win their world title.
And they made a tactical error in giving away the results of the Mankind Rock match. And so I believe within seconds, up to 500,000 homes or fans switched channels, and the rest is history. What should have been a solid victory for WCW turned into a rout by WWE, almost exclusively because they made so many people want to watch our show to see history being made. So even among the WCW fans, there was a feeling that I had been a hardworking guy who had never quite gotten to the top, and there were a lot of fans, even their fans, who wanted to witness it.
You realize this is no disqualification, so I don't care if DX and all the corporation is out here ringside. This match is not going to end up by having a whole bunch of other wrestlers jump in the ring. I mean, it's not going to end up with some kind of wild schmoz out here. This match is going to, somebody's going to win this match, yeah, or somebody's going to lose it.
Not like the other league, as The Rock now hammers away on Mankind, now goes for the steel stairs as you see Mr. McMahon looking on.
And there's your, oh, loser Mankind.
The Rock and I had this great rivalry and a great chemistry. We'd later see it play itself out as tag team partners, but we wouldn't have been those great tag team partners without the rivalry and the chemistry as opponents.
Well, obviously The Rock is here. Obviously he's just checked Mankind in to the SmackDown Hotel on the corner of Know Your Role Boulevard and Jabroni Drive. Maybe a little thirsty, Mankind. He wants some water here.
Oh! Look out! Watch it, Rock! Look at this! Somebody help The Rock!
Jerry Lawler wearing the King's outfit with no t-shirt and a hairy chest somehow made perfect sense in the 90s.
My shirt is almost torn to shreds there, and now I'm going to do a little commentary of my own.
Wait a minute!
Mankind's looking real good.
Yeah,
you look. The kid's showing a lot of testicular.
You're looking
there.
Great.
Man, I love this stuff.
He could taste it again tonight, and he does, Mr. Sacco.
He's the biggest star in the world, and he's got a sock in his mouth.
The Rock may be out.
And this is a real good use of the lumberjacks. It takes a little attention away from what's going in the ring, sets the stage, boom, Austin's music kicks in, and it's arguably top five reactions of all time. Set in for me the moment I held the title, because I had never seen that coming for me, so I never made that my goal. I wanted to have memorable feuds. I wanted to try to move people up the ladder. I wanted to try to create great moments, but never once did I think one of those moments would be holding the WWE title. So because I never let it define success for me, I never felt bad when I did not have it, but I have to tell you, when they handed it to me, it felt more like a Lifetime Achievement Award than it did a WWE title. Raw, 9/27, 1999.
Something that people always talk about.
Let's move on to chicken cutlets.
You want to bring it in?
Can we? Yeah. All right, let's do this and we'll eat.
Classic, everybody.
I feel like I need just a little bit so I'm not thinking about the sandwich.
This is Big Rock. This is important. As a matter of fact, this is your life.
What? What did you? This is what? This is Rock's life.
There's a phrase I use. It's called embracing the ridiculous. And some people, they're just a little short of being able or willing to do that. I think it's those who embrace the ridiculous, who sink their teeth into every opportunity they're given, that really make a difference. And Rock was always in the zone. How neither one of us laughed during this scene, I don't know.
Sure, The Rock remembers you. Sixth grade, home ec class, right? Do you remember how all year long, the only thing The Rock wanted to do in your class was make pancakes?
In home ec?
Uh-oh.
Rock took home ec?
And you never let The Rock make his pancakes, did you?
It's like looking back on it now, he is the biggest star in the world, and I got to be 2 feet away from him. And I'm a straight man in this. Like, I really wanted this to go well.
Well, then The Rock says this. You should know your role and shut your mouth.
Whoa.
Take a little walk down Know Your Role Boulevard. Hang that right on Jabroni Drive. And then proceed to check your Aunt Jemima, no pancake, have an ass.
Ah!
Directly into the SmackDown Hotel.
This is supposed to be The Rock's life. Does he have no respect?
Oh, man. What people don't know about the This Is Your Life is that while almost everyone loved it, one person decidedly did not like it at all, and that was Mr. McMahon.
keep in mind, I think we had 14 minutes slotted, and we went 26 on live national television, primetime TV. They brought in some local actors to portray the coach, the teacher, the former girlfriend.
You remember every Saturday night back in high school how you and The Rock used to sit on your parents' couch?
Uh-oh.
The table read went, okay, I'm going to bring you out, and The Rock will say some stuff, and you'll leave, and then I'll bring you out, The Rock will say some stuff, and you'll leave, and then I'll bring you out, and The Rock will say some stuff, and you leave.
And what did you do? You caught The Rock off on second base!
I believe, do we have Yerpel lined up? Because she was there.
Ladies and gentlemen, say hello to Yerpel!
Yerpel was discovered in Michigan when we visited Mr. McMahon in the hospital. She and her husband had a place called Yerpel and JoJo's Funtime Palace. And one of the heartwarming aspects of the story is that to this day, Yerpel and I are in contact. We sure are.
The fans have been wanting it. They've been asking for it. And now they have Mr. Rocco.
Mr. Rocco. He can pal around with Osako. Well, look at that.
So it's a car wreck of epic proportions, but somehow it's working. It was not until the next day that Dwayne came over to me in catering, and he touched me on the shoulder, and he said, did you hear the rating? And the intonation of his voice made me think that we had tanked. And I said, no. He goes, 7.4, whatever it was. And I went, 7? That's a physical impossibility. And in the days before texting and social media, it had to be hundreds of thousands of people using the phone to tell their friends they had to watch WWE because something special was taking place.
Mick was up all night getting this stuff ready.
You smell it, this rock is cooking. No, you're old.
Stands the test of time. And there've been other attempts to try to recreate that. And they just, you know, I don't think anyone's ever going to get it like that, because part of the beauty is that it was so loosely produced. So you had, Dwayne did have the chance to just make it a star, you know, just such a star vehicle, and with so little effort. And then when it was clear that we had not tanked it, but instead had done the exact opposite of tanking, we went in bold pursuit of Mr. McMahon, and that's when we walked away with the agreement that we could do whatever we wanted from that point on.
Not a pretty sight. Look at this. What's gonna happen when Mankind hits the ring?
Mankind was dark and eerie, and it worked. I'd get down in that boiler room a couple hours before the matches, get used to it, feel like I dwelt there, and I had to create this dark character. I mean, it was a work in progress, but I'll tell you what, I went from being respected journeyman with a gimmick to superstar overnight. That's the way I felt. I felt the change. So there was not a night where I did not realize what an honor it was to be in that ring.